I have in my possession a beautiful photograph, a very simple photograph of that cross. Someone, when they were building the church, the scaffolds were in place, and they had a beautiful angle of the shot of this magnificent cross that enhances this beautiful house of worship. And I remember a story, a true story, of a priest who later became the second Archbishop of Miami, Edward McCarthy. When he was a young priest in the Midwest, the parish that he was assigned to, unfortunately, that church went through a very painful experience. Their church caught fire, and everyone rushed to the church trying to put out the fire, trying to save the church. Unfortunately, it was a wooden church, and it was totally ruined. When they went through the debris, picking up everything that they tried to salvage, they found the corpus of the crucifix, of the cross that enhanced that church. Unfortunately, the cross was totally ruined. The corpus was salvageable, except the fact that it had lost the hands and the feet, the legs. The parish decided to rebuild, and with great efforts, they were able to reconstruct, rebuild their new church. There was great excitement. The fact that they were able to come back again as a community in a new worship space to give thanks to God for the resources that they were able to gather so that they could have a beautiful place of worship. But then the big question, what are we to do with the corpus? Because now, with all the beautiful decorations in the church and the paintings and everything new, and it's no longer a wooden church, it clashes. So we need to buy a new cross. And the people said, no, we can't do that. It's part of who we are. It's part of our history. We cannot get rid of this corpus. Well, we can put it, maybe make a museum. No museum. That corpus belongs inside the worship space. It's part of our history, of who we are. So they were brainstorming, what are we to do? How are we going to place the corpus in the church and somehow convey that message to others? And then the bright idea, as they mounted the cross and the crucified Lord against the wall in the back, they wrote the following statement on both sides of the crucifix. It says, I have no hands, I have no feet. Could you be my hands and feet? So everyone that came through the doors of that church, as they contemplated that beautiful corpus without hands and feet, were invited to take a close look and reflect on that question. Could you be my hands and feet? The readings today invite us to discover that we have a lot in common with Amos and with the disciples of Jesus. Yes, you and I, as baptized members of the church, members of the body of Christ, have a lot in common with the prophet Amos and with the disciples. Amos, in the first reading, clearly stated, I am no prophet. I'm a simple man. But God called me, and he called me to prophesy. I am only doing what God has asked me to do. And because he's asked me to prophesy, that I will do. Prophesy. The disciples responded to the call of the Lord to follow him. And as they journeyed with Jesus, they were witnesses of the incredible, powerful, miraculous signs that Jesus was performing throughout all of Galilee, exorcising demons, healing the sick, providing nourishment to thousands of people that would gather to hear him. They were totally amazed at what they were seeing. And then Jesus invited them to do the same. He called them. Now you go. And now I give you this instruction. Bring nothing with you except a walking stick, the sandals on your feet, and do the following things in my name. They heard the call and they embraced it. And without any hesitation, they went through the task that the Lord placed in their hands. Now remember, Jesus only told them, take a walking stick and sandals. There was no how-to book handed out to them. Just simply the ability to trust, to allow the Lord to work through them. And they were able to enter into this journey without anything. And the Lord provided. And great things occurred because they trusted in faith. You and I have also been called by the Lord. You and I have also been asked by the Lord to exercise a role in the life of the church. Beginning at home, the domestic church, in the manner in which we allow the Lord to be the center of our household, as we invoke the Lord's name together, setting time for prayer, before a meal, when we wake up, before we go to bed. But the opportunity is there for us to enhance the life of our family by invoking the Lord's name. And not only invoking the Lord's name, but by asking ourselves, how are we engaged in ministry? By becoming active members of Corpus Christi Parish. And if you're visiting, wherever that home parish is that you're a part of, how are you and I making a difference in the life of our community? Becoming lectors, servers, members of a choir, greeters, assisting as extraordinary ministers of Holy Communion, visiting the sick and the homebound in hospitals, nursing homes, catechist, sharing the gift of faith with others. There's many wonderful opportunities that you and I have to respond to the call that the Lord has extended to each and every one of us. And not only here within these wonderful sacred walls that allow us to come together, but how are we responding to that call by sharing what we have received here out there in the world? If you ever visit St. John Vianney Parish, where I have been serving for the last 4 years now, entering my fifth as pastor, I was able to put a sign that surrounds every single corner of our church. No matter where you're at, no matter which door you choose to exit from, you will encounter this message, this wake-up call that helps us to be aware of the call that the Lord has extended to each and every one of us. We are prophetic people. Out of darkness, God has called each and every one of us to be a holy nation, exercising a royal priesthood given to us at baptism. And so the reminder at each door is the following. When you open those doors and you exit, beware. You are now entering missionary territory. When we go out there, we find an incredible field, a rich field, because God's children are out there. And you and I are called to engage those brothers and sisters out there who may not have had the opportunity of connecting with the Lord because of the chaos that we encounter out there in the world. There is loneliness, there is sadness, there is resentments, violence, war, crime, you name it. There's a lot of dangers out there. And many are disoriented because they have not encountered the Lord like you and I have had the blessing of encountering. And that's why the Lord is asking us to go into the fields to rescue those brothers and sisters, to help them find the way, the route that will connect with them, with the Lord. Christ depends on each and every one of us. That's why he has called us. We're not here by accident. We're here because of his great love for us and the talents and gifts that he knows that you and I have been blessed with, that have been given to us for a purpose. In many different ways, we're called to answer that call. Let's get involved. Let's roll up our sleeves. Let's get to work for the good of God's kingdom. The Lord has come to save us, to embrace us as members of one family. All we need to do is trust. All we need to do is answer with a resounding yes and say to the Lord, I want to be your hands and feet, so that others may encounter you and enjoy the fullness of the blessings you have in store for us.